Thank you, Drew. We appreciate that opening. Welcome to those that are joining us on our internet service and folks in all over the world. If you follow us on Facebook at all, have you noticed we have folks from Kenya, Africa, Cambodia, Germany, Philippines, India. I mean, there's folks from all around the world that are joining with us. We're so glad to have them with us. And I know especially our dear friend from India, Laban, watches us at about 7 o'clock in the evening in India. And so good to have he and his family and lots of folks join with us. Good to have you that are here this morning. We have a great number of things to do. I'm going to pick on Anna if I can for just a minute. Do you mind if I you don't even know, but you're just like impromptu. All right. So share, if you would, with us what happened last week, what prompted your Facebook post. Do you mind doing that real quick?
I was sick with COVID and I ended up in the hospital and I recovered, and my husband had asked for prayers, and I knew my church family was praying for me and friends, and so I knew I wanted to respond on Facebook instead of individually responding to every comment that everyone put. And last Sunday's message about sharing your faith and just reaching out to people and asking them, the Romans Road, right?
Mm-hmm.
The Romans Road. And anyway, so I went on there and basically gave my testimony of the whole experience, that I was never in fear. I knew God had this. I knew that my family and friends were all supporting me in prayer, and I never feared it. And then I just, my prayer for them was that they knew Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And I just went on and on.
Amen. Yes. Well, thank you very much. I put her right on the spot. Didn't I do that? Nobody will ever say anything anymore because they say, I don't want him to ask me in front of everybody. Yes. Yeah. Amen. And has anybody responded to your post?
One girl responded that she goes, I needed to hear that.
Well, good. Good, good. So it was interesting because last week we talked about sharing our faith and how important that is and how awkward it is. I mean, we share our political views, we share what we like about fishing or sports or anything like that. Without any fear, we'll do that anywhere. But when it comes to sharing our faith, it's like we get lockjaw. We're so afraid someone's going to reject us for what we believe. And so prompted by my little phrase of the Romans Road, Anna inquired about that, found out what it was, put it on her post, and it was such a blessing to me just to see it actually happen. And I asked her to share with me the first time that she shared that, and the next day she sent me the Facebook page. So we really appreciate that. It's good to be able to share a faith. It's interesting, you have no hate literature, nobody's threatened to burn your house down. Nobody said, I'm going to unfriend you and never not like you again. Isn't that interesting? All these fears that we have that if we share our faith, all those things are going to happen. But instead, what'd you say? I really needed that. That's what someone said to you. So I'm just encouraging last week's sermon about sharing our faith. It's an important thing. You'd be surprised that most of the fear that we have comes from our arch enemy, the devil, who doesn't want us to share our faith. And so he puts all this fear in us. And then we do it, and someone wants it, and we go, really? Like, we're surprised that they really want it. So I encourage you to do that. Well, in this time that we live where there's so many voices saying so many things, and we don't know who to believe, it is nice to know that we have the voice of truth. Stand with me, if you would. Let's sing together. The words are on the screen in front of you.
Crashing waves, to step out of my comfort zone into the realm of the unknown where Jesus is. And he's holding out his hand. But the waves are calling out my name and they laugh at me, reminding me of all the times I tried before and failed. The waves, they keep on telling me time and time again, boy, you never win. You never win.
Is about who we listen to, and boy, in this world is so, there's so many voices. I don't know if you ever experienced this, is sometimes before I know it, I'm repeating the wrong voice instead of the voice of truth, and because we're just so crowded, media and co-workers and family members, everybody telling us what they think about something, and we lose our perspective of what God's word says. And when it really boils down to it, what's the only thing that matters? What God's word says. But it is hard. It is hard. It's a struggle. And if you don't struggle with that, you pray for me, okay? And then I'll pray for you in case you have that struggle too. The voice of truth. Father, thank you so much today for giving us the opportunity to be here today like we are, to be able to stand shoulder to shoulder with folks that believe your word have trusted you as their Savior and who want to listen to the voice of truth. Lord, we thank you for our family that's here. We thank you for our guest. We thank you, Lord, most importantly, that you're here. And you said where two or three are in my name, I'm in the midst. And we thank you, Lord, for being with us. From our standpoint, we put our best clothes on. We are acting the best that we've ever acted the whole week. And we kind of feel like we're good. But Lord, you see right through all that facade. And you see the heart, that we're deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And yet, in spite of that, your love is stronger than our sin. And you want to be with us in spite of who we are. And Lord, we just rejoice in that today. And I pray, Father, that you'd bless us, bless the singing, bless the testimony, bless the witness of your word as it's preached. And I pray, Father, that you'd give us a time of rejoicing around you and the things that are true. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Remain standing for prayer. If you got a bulletin, how many? Did everybody get a bulletin? If you didn't get a bulletin, this is the time to pick it out. It'll also be on the screen before you, but it's the next song. I love this song. Tell Me the Story of Jesus, right on my heart, every word. It's an old traditional hymn, and let's lift our voices together as we sing it. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you very much. All through the summer, the choir not singing, we've had specials, and it's always been good to hear different folks come up and sing. We had a few weeks there where nobody volunteered, and so Stan and Drew and Lisa grabbed us, and we all kind of got together and sang, and then there was three or four of those. We had a great time singing in a quartet. Today, we continue in this special music, and we have a youngster that's going to come and play. Do we know who that is? Okay, all right. Did I know that song? What was it? Oh, okay, all right. I was just checking to make sure the one I thought it was what it was. Now you can relax. Okay. Oh, I remember those days. I could play it on the trumpet 20,000 times and it perfect. Get up in front of church and play the trumpet, and I hit every one of the notes was wrong. And after the first one was downhill totally, but I mean it was really bad after that. So, well, very, very good. Thank you, sir. Now you'll be able to enjoy the rest of your day. Okay, great. All right, we're going to dismiss the kids and 3 years old to fifth grade. Goodbye. They'd prefer to stay in here. You can tell that, right? Ben, did you have a good time yesterday?
Yeah.
Yep. You like the bugs the most, right?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. I never saw so much off sprayed. And it worked. We didn't get close to one another. The bugs didn't care at all. It didn't keep the bugs off. It just kept us from each other. So,
yeah.
No mosquitoes, that's right. That was good, yeah. Amen. I've heard that song played like 600,000 times at home. Titus working so hard to try to get it, you know. And you think, as your kids grow up, if there's something I'd rather them practice a whole lot at, to get really good at, it would be something that had spiritual connotations to it. And what a blessing to hear him play. I heard all the mistakes you didn't hear today, and then bang, like this, you know, and then he'd start all over again. And so it was, what a blessing. Well, this next song is a song I've mentioned to you before. The songs in the hymn book, we often discard them because they're not contemporary songs. And well, contemporary just means it's new. When I first got saved, all these songs were new to me. So I guess they were contemporary, right? Even though they'd been written for years and years earlier. But the songs in a hymn book have such a connection to biblical truth. And a lot of times the contemporary songs are good melody, but they're not connected too well to the truth. And not all of them, but some of them. And this is a great song. There was a time in the Christian faith where being a Christian wasn't about being ashamed. It was about being a declaration, that people weren't afraid to say that they knew Christ their Savior. But it was like I gave up my old life to do this. And this next song is one of those songs that challenges it. And it's just a cry out. It says, who's on the Lord's side? You know, who's gonna stand up and say, yeah, as for me and my house, we're gonna Lord. We don't have a lot of that anymore. We become so timid and so afraid that someone's going to actually find out that we're a Christian, and then we have to, you know, be on our best behavior or something. But there was a time in the history of Christianity where it was a joy to be able to say, I'm standing here, and I don't care if everyone knows it. I'm not doing it because I'm better than anybody else. I'm doing it to say that I've chosen what side I'm going to stand on. And I don't know if you've been through that in your personal walk yet. If you're not, you're going to have a hard time singing this song. But if you have, it's not like you do it once and then it's over with. It's every day you realize that, you know, you have to do it again. I've got to make this stand. Right after I got saved on the jet going over to Hawaii. And when I landed, I realized I had to make some big changes in my life. And so I went to work in an office in this Marine, Conway Marine Corps Air Station, and there was like 25 to 30 men working in this office. And I went in there and I thought, man, I can't tell anybody I'm a Christian. Marine Corps and everything else, you know, that'd be bad. And but the Lord just kept working on my heart and said, you got to declare what side you're on, because they will assume that you're on their side. And so I remember one day I had this dime store Bible. It was one of those that makes it look like it's leather, but it's really just cardboard, you know. And I remember I decided I was going to take it to work with me. And, you know, I didn't want to be real noticeable. So, you know, I did one of these numbers like this as I'm walking in, like nobody can see it because of this massive arm right here, you know. And so I'm walking in like this, you know, and it didn't matter how much I covered that Bible. When I walked in that door, I mean, it's like the whole office shut down. And they're all like looking at me. And they're looking down at this massive arm was trying to cover. And I went to my desk and I put it like this. I sat down on my desk like this. And the whole office, even in other offices, they were coming out and looking like this because they heard something was really strange going on out there. And I sat down on the edge of my desk. I was never treated the same after that day. And at first that really hurt my feelings. But later I realized that was my opportunity to say, who's on the Lord's side? I was going to make that declaration. And when I left that office, everyone from the highest on the chain of command to the lowest came up to me, grabbed a hold of my hand, said, John, I wish I could live it like you lived it. Now listen, the answer is not living it. The answer is accepting the only one who could live it. And that's Jesus Christ. Amen. But what they did is they were saying, I saw Jesus in you. And that's what we all want. We want the world to see Jesus in us. Not that we're Jesus, but we want to introduce them to them. And I just want to say this song has such strength as we sing it. It asks the question, who is on the Lord's side? Who will serve the King? Who will be his helpers, other lives to bring? Who will leave the world side? Who will face the foe? Who is on the Lord's side? Who for him will go? And then you ask those questions, you say, well, I want to, but man, how can I do that? And so the refrain says, by thy call of mercy, by thy grace divine, we are on the Lord's side, Savior, we are thine. And now, if you're not familiar with the song, you won't know what I just said. But if you are familiar with the song, you can feel it. The Spirit of God just bears witness to the truth of that song. Stand with me, if you would. Let's sing it together, this great song. Y'all like volunteering, right? Someone says, who would like to do this? You raise your hand right away, right? No. You think, you do that one time, you learn, don't ever do that again. Amen. Amen. I stood on those, I think they were yellow footprints. And they said, you know, who wants to do this? And, you know, man, I was ready to go. And man, I paid for that dearly. So I learned after that, you raise your hand, but don't do it the quickest. Raise it quick, because then you'll get in trouble if you don't do it quick. But don't be the quickest, all right? But this is one of those things that you can give it all up for Jesus. Every bit of it. And sing it for him. Let's sing together. Amen. You may be seated. What a song of commitment. What a song of commitment. You made your commitments today to him. That day that I mentioned so many years ago, I was 19 years of age. Now at 20, it seems so long ago. That was supposed to be a joke, okay. It seems so long ago, but I never ever regret that day. Never. Never regret that day. And what God did in my life and in my heart that day, I had the opportunity each time that I moved, went to a different position, different job, to be able to do it again and see the same results that people mocked me in public and they loved me privately. They'd find me when no one else could see that they were coming to me, and they'd pour their heart out to me and say, please pray for my mom or my dad or for me or something. But as soon as I said, sure, I will, and had prayer with them like that, and they, oh, thank you so much. We walked outside the door into the public, and they started cursing and swearing and mocking me again. Just the same face. They didn't want anybody to think that they were like me, amen. But I never regretted it, amen. It was such a blessing, and we always want to declare whose side that we're on. Don't be afraid or ashamed. Aren't you glad that Jesus didn't? And there he was hanging on the cross between heaven and earth. And he did it for you and for me. Wasn't ashamed of you and me. I don't know about you, but he had plenty of reason to be ashamed of me. But he wasn't. He took it all. And so what an opportunity for us to be able to be as public for him in the world that we live. Our focus is in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1 today. If you have your Bibles, I encourage you to turn there. Nothing like the sound of pages, God's Word turning. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 1. Everybody says, oh, one verse, it'll be a short sermon. Oh, no, never, amen. One verse, that's just to fake you out, amen. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you. If you and I were talking, I beg you. We beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you're called. God's desire, given through the Apostle Paul, is to beg us to walk the walk that God's called for us to walk. And so our focus for the past few weeks have been on the church, the vocation of the church. What God's called us to do. And so we've explored several things. One, the importance of the church. We learned how important God's local church is. Now you look around today, we're down because a lot of folks are afraid to come with this COVID thing going on. But even when we're all here, we still don't fill all the pews. And we're just one of many churches like that. That at one time couldn't hold everybody that was there, and now we dwindle down. It's because so many people forget the importance of the local church. And when they forget the importance of the local church, then about anything can be more important than that. Someone says, let's go fishing, and it's more important than church. Or let's go do this, and it's more important than church. We're coming in. I have to tell on Andrew this morning. He was up late last night. Stan was a slave driver. Man, he kept him up all night. Amen. Got home late last night. They were working here at church. Got up this morning. His eyes were about half mass. And he says, this is the day I wish you weren't a preacher. I said, what? He said, because I could sleep in and not go to Sunday school. Well, he's just tired, physically tired. And what did I say to you? I said, what if today they were going to King's Island? Would you be as tired? And he said, no, not at all. He said, because King's Island was important. And I'm just picking on him because we had that conversation. But in a world where everything else is more important, what we intended to do was to show that, and from God's perspective, church is important. Secondly, we talked about the most asked questions. I get asked so many questions about the church, and so we tried to take some time to answer those questions. And then we talked about the vocation, what we read this morning, walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you're called, the vocation of the church. What is it that we're supposed to do? What is it that we're about? Do we come in here and boredom Sunday and recite a few things, hear a few things, so we walk out and feel better? Is that what it's all about? Not according to the Bible. And we spent some time talking about what it is that God asked the church to do. And one of the last of those things is what Anna picked up from last week. And that is, we have a mission. We're supposed to tell people about this treasure that we have on the inside. And so today we bring this series of the church to a close. Now, before you get real excited about that, it's the close of 5 weeks. All right, so there's five more weeks, but this is the close of the 5 weeks. I didn't want you to think today was the end of it. It's like, you know, it's hard when you get started to stop right mid-thing. But I wanted to bring this thought of the church to a close, and in 3 weeks we will be done. But I wanted to focus on the administration or the management of the church. Sounds like an exciting subject, doesn't it? Actually, I think you will find it very interesting. And in order to answer the question about the administration or the management of the church, we're going to have to ask ourselves three questions. And we're going to take each one of these questions in the next weeks to come. Number one, who? Number two, what? And number three, why? These are the questions. And the Apostle Paul will be our instructor and help us to answer on administration of the church. Who is supposed to administrate? What are we supposed to administrate? And why are we supposed to administrate? And I hope that you'll find this encouraging as we walk through it. If you're there still in Ephesians chapter 4, notice verses 11 through 13. And if you didn't bring your Bible, I put it on the overhead so you can see it. Notice what he says in verse 11. And he, God, Jesus Christ, he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come into the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, into a perfect man under the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Now, these verses tell us quite a few things. Number one, that Christ gave gifts or divine abilities, if you would, and he gave these gifts unto man or to men, not meaning masculine only, but to humankind. All right? He gave these gifts to humankind, and he gave these gifted people whom he gave gifts to the church. In verse number 11, this is what it says, that he gave it to the church with an intent. And that intent is really very, very interesting. These are the gifted individuals and the intent for a specific reason. And the verses following tell us, this is a perfect outline of the Bible. If you look at verse 12, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, and for the edifying of the body of Christ. That's the reason he gifted these people and gave these people to the church, for these three reasons: to perfect the saints, the work of the ministry, and for the edifying of the body of Christ. All right? These groups of people that he gave. And notice, if you would, from these, that there was a specific reason for doing that. The next verse there. There you go. Till we all come in the unity of faith. One. Two, the knowledge of the Son of God. And three, the measure of the stature of Christ. That's the purpose. So from these verses that we look at, the intent, the specific reason, and what he gave as gifts, we ask this question: who is responsible for the administration of God's people, the church? According to the text that we've read, it won't surprise you that Christ is the first responsible one. The one for being in charge or managing God's church is Jesus Christ. That shouldn't be earth-shattering. Amen. In fact, Paul tells us in verse 15 of chapter 4, but speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things. Now notice what it says, which is the head, even Christ. He's the head of the church. That shouldn't shock us. In fact, in chapter 5, verse 23, you don't have to turn there, but Paul places Christ as the head of the church, and in verse 24, admonishes the church, the people, not the building, to be in subjection to Christ. So Who's supposed to be in charge of the church? Christ is to be in charge of the church. Now, of course, Jesus is no longer on earth, right? So if Christ was on the earth, we could say, Jesus, come up and tell us what we're supposed to do. But he's not on the earth. And so since he's not on the earth, how then can he care for the administrative work of the church? And the answer goes back to verse 11, which we've already read this morning. He does it through delegation. Notice it says, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. This was his method. This is the way he was going to do it. He's the head of the church, but through delegation, he said, this is how it's supposed to work. Now, let's pick that apart for a minute and just look at it. He gave some apostles and some prophets. The work of the apostles and prophets in the Old Testament was merely to speak God's word. That's what they were supposed to do. And we read all the way through it. If you're reading through the Bible in a year along with us, Ezekiel, boy, wonderful, and Isaiah, all these prophets, and they spoke, and people wrote down what they spoke, and that was the word of God. Nobody had a Bible. They couldn't go and pick up the Bible and say, what does God say? They listened to the prophets and the apostles. And then the prophets and the apostles, they wrote what they read. Others write it, and some of them, they wrote it. They would put it on pieces of paper, and that's where we get our Bible today. As a result of that, the Bible today, when the work of the apostles and the prophets ceased, the Bible today serves as our sole authority and the main responsibility for the administration of the church. So today, instead of Christ standing here in his person, he gives us these prophets and these apostles who gave us his word so that we could have his word and have Jesus stand in front of us through the written word. And that's how we know what Jesus wants the church to do and how he wants it to be managed and how he wants it to be run by his word through delegation. These were the prophets and the apostles. Now, as a result of them giving us his word and it being the sole responsibility for us, we call ourselves Bible believers. I had so much fun with that when I first got saved. People say, what church you go to? They always want to identify, like, you know, put you in a little cubbyhole of who you are. You know, what church you go to? And, well, then you say, I go to a Baptist church. It's like, you know, you have the plague. You know, oh, you're one of them. You know, and so, you know, someone say, what church you go to? Say, boy, it's sunny today, isn't it? And they go, huh? You know, because you don't want to say it, because everybody going to put you in this little box that, you know, one of those guys that go in the water all the time till your fingers start shriveling up and look like they're wet all the time. So that's what they have you in this little box. But so I threw everybody off. I said, well, I'm a Bible believer. And you should see, if you could add a picture of the brain that says, Church of God, Church of Christ, Church of God. They're going down through. They never have heard Bible believer before. What church is that? But I would just say, because who's responsible for the administration of the church through delegation is God's word. It's Christ. In his word, he gave us this instruction of what we're supposed to do. And as a result of that, rather than being a Baptist first, I'm a Bible believer first. And they'd go, oh. Like they didn't have a clue what I just said. And at that young age, I wasn't sure I did either. But I said it. I mean, it sounded really impressive. But Bible, we call ourselves Bible believers. Now, on that list that God gifted people to give to the church, it was prophets and apostles. What was the third thing? You remember what the third thing is? Get me the next one. Evangelists. Evangelists. So he gave apostles and some prophets and some evangelists. All right, it's kind of an interesting thing. The term evangelist is only used three times in the Bible. You may not have known that. Only three times in the entire Bible. And all of them are in the New Testament, which is kind of interesting. One of the places, the first place, is Acts chapter 21, verse number 8. Notice what it says. And the next day, we that were of Paul's company departed and came to Caesarea, and we entered into the house of Philip, the evangelist. Isn't that interesting? Now notice this, which was one of the seven. So there were seven of them. One of the seven. And abode with them. Now it's kind of interesting. In order to understand that, the reference takes us back to Acts chapter 6. And in Acts chapter 6, if you're not familiar with that, it starts out in verse number 1. And in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplied, there was a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews because their widows were neglected in the daily, see the word? It's where we get our word administration. They were neglected in the daily ministration. Then the 12 apostles, called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. And we've got it all backwards today. We have pastors who should be giving themselves to the word and prayer, outdoing the work of those people who should be taking care of the administration. There are more troubles in churches that I've been in because the pastor tried to do the work that they have no business doing instead of doing the work that they're supposed to do. But he says it's not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. And so what was their alternative? What was their suggestion? The next verse. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you seven men of honest report. You knew they couldn't be Baptist, right? I'm just kidding. Honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. In order to make sure that the administration of the church was handled properly, we don't want the pastor doing that. That's what they said. We're going to look out and find us people that are honest, full of the Holy Spirit of God, and full of wisdom, spiritual wisdom, who we may appoint over this business. But we, these are the elders, these are the pastors, we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And the saying pleased the whole multitude. It's a very interesting concept, one that we've got completely twisted around in the modern church today. We have pastors going out serving everybody's physical needs instead of worrying about the spiritual needs. The pastor should be always interested in the spiritual need. That doesn't mean he doesn't say hi to anybody. It doesn't mean that he didn't go visit anybody that's sick. It means that the work, the primary work of the pastor, is to make sure not that he holds your hand, but that he leads you in the right way that God wants you to go. If this seems odd and strange, I'm sorry, but it's biblical. It's the way it's supposed to be. Now notice it says, as they said, this is the kind of person we're supposed to get. Verse number 5 says, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Ghost, and who? Philip. Now if you look in the passage, we're not going to read the names, but there were 7 of them. Stephen, Philip, and 5 others. That's what it says, Philip the evangelist, who was one of the 7. That's where it came from, Acts chapter 6. Now, it's kind of interesting. These men were chosen to take care of the ministration or the administration management of the widows in the church. And among their many gifts that they had was evangelism. Notice in verse 6 and 7, where it says there in Acts chapter 6, and the word of God increased, and the number of the disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly. How does that happen? People got saved. People were one to the Lord, and they began to grow in the grace and the knowledge of the Lord. That's the way that God intended it to work. So the first time evangelist is used in the Bible is Acts chapter 21. The next time is where we are right now in Ephesians. And then the third time is 2 Timothy. Now your notes say 3:5. This is just to show you I am not infallible. It should be 4:5. Okay? The reference that's in your notes is correct, but the verse is, but the reference is wrong. It should be 4:5, chapter 4, verse 5. Here Paul is instructing young Timothy as a preacher of the gospel, and he says to him, but watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the what? The work. He didn't say be an evangelist. He said do the work of an evangelist. It seems to me that as the apostles and the prophets ceased at the completion of God's word, didn't need prophets, didn't need apostles after the Bible was completed. We already have it. Once the Bible was completed, we no longer needed apostles or prophets. because God's word became that, that the evangelist also ceased at the establishment and the formation of God's church. There was no need for these evangelists anymore because God formed his church and got it put together. Later, Paul would pass the responsibility of evangelism, just like it's mentioned here, do the work of an evangelist. He passed this responsibility of evangelism on to everyone that was a member of the church. And that's what I was speaking about last week. But if you would, look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And if you don't have your Bible, I put it on the overhead. But 2 Corinthians chapter number 5. And notice this is exactly what Paul is saying in verses 18 through 20. That those lists that we read, God gave some prophets, some apostles, and some evangelists, that those three are gone. There's no need. He replaced the prophets and apostles with his word, and he replaced the evangelist with you and me. And we're supposed to do the work of an evangelist. Notice it says right here, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ. You see, we were at odds with Jesus because I'm a sinner and he's righteous. And the only way that being at odds could be remedied is by Jesus Christ dying on the cross and reconciling us to him. He forgave us. That's how we reconcile. If you're married, you all know all about that, right? Amen. You ever had one of those knockdown, blowout, burnout? I'm going to my side of the house and you're staying in your side of the house. Everybody's looking down at their feet. I don't know what that's about. Okay, but and somehow or another you get reconciled. And all of a sudden you're friends again. The only way we could ever be friends with God is through the reconciliation of Jesus Christ, who died in our place and paid the price for us. And so this is what it says, and of all things are God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ. Now notice the next phrase, and I highlighted and underlined it. I would have put it a different color, but I'm colorblind. And hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. Keith, you and I, we have this ministry. Philip was an evangelist. You and I are supposed to do the work of an evangelist. God gave to us this ministry. Notice what it says, to wit, that's an old English word that means that is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath done what? Hath committed unto us, not the work, but the word of reconciliation. Where he told Timothy to do the work of evangelism, he told us to take the word of reconciliation. What you and I are supposed to do is go out there and say, Jesus Christ died for your sins. You can be reconciled. That's what God's called us to do. And so as the apostle and the prophet, work is done because we have a completed Bible. And the work of the evangelist to get the message of Jesus out in the early church is done. God took that work and he gave it to all of us. We don't have to be evangelists. We just have to be someone that's committed to others to give the word of reconciliation. Jesus died for your sins. You can be saved. And it's a wonderful thing. So that's what God's done. And so hence young Timothy was told to do the work of an evangelist. And the work today of an evangelist is the word. And that's saying to people, Jesus died for your sins. Do you remember the first time someone told you that? You said, oh, I want that. No. I mean, most of us weren't like that. When someone first told us that, what did we say? Oh, no. One of those. And then some tragedy came along our way. And someone said, hey, Jesus died for your sin. You go, really? Because God uses tragedies in our life, failures in our life. We're tender. And we're open for help. And God sends his little messengers of reconciliation to those people in their time of need. I don't know how many times over the years I've had someone that cussed the hinges off the door at me. I mean, they call me everything they could call me. And then they'd call me to a room and they'd say, my brother's dying. would you go up and tell him what you've told me? Isn't that interesting? They reject what I tell them openly, publicly. But when someone is at the throngs of death, right at the threshold of death, they want me to go tell them about Jesus Christ. So God's given us this treasure in an earthen vessel that we can go and tell them, you don't have to be saved. I remember Ernie in the hospital, and his brother's the one that sent me to him. And I went up to Ernie, the first words out of his mouth is, I'm a goner. There he lay dying in the bed. I guess I'm a goner. And he said to me, Ernie, let me ask you a question. If you died today, do you know for sure where you'd spend eternity? He said, no, I don't know. I said, if someone could show you from the Bible how you could know, would you be interested in knowing? Well, yeah. And I opened the Bible and I took him down the Romans road. And I started the first one all the way down. I was so excited, I was reading that fast. You know, I'm usually a slow talker. But I mean, I was really going fast. And I got to the end. I said, you know what that says? He says, yeah. I said, do you want to trust Jesus as your Savior today? He said, I sure do. And he bowed his head and he asked Jesus to come in his heart. I was so excited, I wanted to go back to work to tell his brother the next day. I mean, I was chomping at the bit, and I got out to see his brother, and his brother cussed me every which direction. And after all the other people that were around left, he said, took me into a room, and he said, what happened? I said, your brother asked Jesus to come in his heart and save him. He said, I know. He called me, and he told me. And he died this morning. And just before he died, he asked Jesus Christ to come and save his heart. And his brother thanked me for telling him. When we walked out there, there were three or four journeymen out there in the yard. And he began to cuss and to swear. And he said, this is a stupid guy. Don't ever listen to him. And on about that. But I knew deep down in his heart. Because God has given us this word of reconciliation. All right. So we have Christ at the head of the administration. Right? He's the one that's in charge. And his word is the authority of administration. And he does it through delegation. And we know that the prophet and the apostle, no longer here, their work is done. We have a completed scripture. And the evangelist is no longer here because God's given us that ministry to do. So what's left in that verse? I thought you'd never ask. Let's look at it. Verse 11 again. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and what? Some pastors and teachers. All right. So, with Christ as the chief shepherd and the Word of God as our standing operating procedure, God's gift the church with pastors that are instructed to manage or care for his earthly body by preaching and teaching the Bible. Now, I'm going to say a few things here and I'm going to be done. You know what that means? Not a thing. But I'm going to try to make it as brief as I can, all right? But I want you to follow this along in your Bible. And if you didn't bring your Bible, make sure you look at the verses on the screen, okay, so that you can see this. Because this next statement I'm getting ready to make is going to freak you out. And I don't mean to freak you out. Most of you who know me would not be offended if I said this just to you. Because you know me. But I don't want you to freak out. Here's what it says. These men who God gifts as pastors and teachers to give to the church for administration, these men are first of all to rule God's people. Now don't have a cardiac on me. I know. I know the human nature. To do what? Okay. But to rule God's people. Rule simply means to govern. Or, as we're going to see in a verse, and you'll be able to identify, to take care of. To control by established laws. That is, he's to take the standing operating procedures, that's his book, amen, and he's to seek to manage the actions, the choices, the behaviors of God's people. How? By reminding them. That's the reason we come to church on Sunday, just because you can't wait till next week to hear my stories? No. They are good stories, though. You have to admit some of them. I'm just kidding. But you come because what we want to do is hear, does God have anything to say about this? And the answer is, yes, he does. And in fact, the voice of truth, he's the only voice we're to listen to. No other voice. My grandma, when she got it, no disrespect, but I don't care what your grandma did. I don't mean that to be mean. I just mean the church is not about our grandmas or our grandpas or the people that bought that pew. The only thing that matters is what God's word says. And if we would stick to what God's word with, the only one we'd have a complaint with would be with God. Because his word is very clear. So what a pastor and teachers are supposed to do is remind us of what God's word says. And notice the use of this word throughout the Bible, this rule. All right, because I don't want you to have a cardiac on me. Look at Hebrews chapter 13. Some of you are leaning a little bit left. I don't know if that's cardiac or bored. No, I'm just kidding. Hebrews chapter 13, look at verse 7. This is what God's word says. Remember them which have what? The rule over you. When we read that, what we're thinking about is somebody's, you know, like this. But that's not how it's used in the Bible at all. Notice what it says. Remember them that have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God. See, that they're to remind you of the truth. Whose faith, their faith, follow. Considering the end of their conversation, not just what they say. In the Bible, conversation means your way of life, how you live. Some of you have been very kind to me. Well, all of you have, but some of you have been extremely kind. You've put me a little text to me and say, we want our lives or our families to be like yours. And I mean, that is so humbling and it's wonderful. I'm so glad you're not God, because you would know what you see is probably not really what's totally there all the time. Are y'all with me? You see the best. Man, I'm not going to come in here like I woke up this morning when I got one side of my head sticking up, my hair sticking up like I'm a rooster, and my breath so bad it'd melt the plastic in front of me. And I don't want you to see me like that. So I, you know, put all this stuff on my head to get it to look, and put clothes on and brush my teeth about 50 times, and you get the best. But do you think I'm like this all the time? No. But you know what you're saying? You're saying, I see in your life and in your family an example that I want to follow. And that's the way God intended it to be. Remember them that have the rule. They're taking care of you, who have spoken to you the word of God, whose faith follow. Do that. Considering the end of their conversation, you say, well, I like what God's doing in that family. That's the way God intended it to be. In verse number 17, he goes on and he says this, obey them that have, there it is again, the rule over you, and submit yourselves. Why? Because they're ogres, and men, they're kings, and they want to beat you down and take control of you. No. The reason you do it is because they watch for your souls. And they do it as those who must give account. One day I've got to give account to God for Ben over here. Not for everything he's done, but for how I've responded to what he's done. And I want to do it, look what it says, with joy and not with grief. Because if it's for grief, it's not profitable for him. That means it's not going good, okay? And that's what he says, for that is unprofitable unto you. The rule is not about being an ogre or being demanding or being controlling. It is about being full of care and love. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 4 and 5. Look what it says about these elders. One that ruleth well, here's the example, his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity, seriousness. And then this parenthesis, like, here's why this is important. This is why it's important for him to have good rule in his house and having his children in subjection. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, notice what it says, How shall he rule the church of God? No, what does it say? How shall he care? See, that's what rule means, is the care. It's not about being an ogre or being in charge or a dictator. It's about care. You folks that have kids, you know the battles. Keith, when you in the testimony, I won't give all the testimony, but when you made that appeal, didn't he? You know how hard it is to raise kids in this world. I mean, that's real. That's where we all live. And when my kids do something wrong, I don't, you stupid idiot, what did you do that for? I've seen some parents, sadly, who've done that. But I go to them. And I have a come now, let us reason together time to time. And I sit down with them and I say, now, here's why this is not right. And here's the reason you don't want to do that. You know why I do that? Because I'm not an ogre. It's because I care for them. You know what I'm saying? Your heart bleeds for them. You want what's best for them. And you don't just go like a military man giving orders or saying, I'm your father and you'll do what I tell you to do. Although, that does help every once in a while. But, amen. It's your heart. It's your passion. See, that's what God gave and some pastors and teachers for. Not to minister and administer for the Grecian widows and Hebrew widows. Not the daily administration, but for the spiritual administration of the church. He did it because they must watch for your souls. Let's look at one more. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 17. Let the elders that, there it is again, that rule well, be counted worthy of double money. Now, I know some pastors that like that part if it said money, but that's not what it says. Okay. What does it say? Double honor. And the ones that are really outgoing and really are very nice to get to know and they're very friendly and all like that, is that the ones that get the double honor? Not according to the text. What's the measure of the double honor? Especially they who labor in the word and in doctrine. You get a pastor and a teacher that is interested in you understanding this book as it applies to daily living and wants to put it in your soul, that man is worthy of double honor because his motive is true and right. Now, I hope that you and I are together till Jesus sounds the trumpet. But statistically, that probably won't be that guy. You'll get a job somewhere, you guys are going to have to leave. I don't know that that happened, but statistically. And I don't want you to say sometime in your life, boy, that John Young, he sure played softball good. And I want you to say, boy, that guy sure know how to nail two boards together. I don't know how to play softball or nail two boards. So I use that as an example. You know what I want you to be able to remember? I can't even remember the guy's name, but man, I'll tell you what, he was intent on getting that book into my heart. I can't even remember. What was his wife's name, by the way? I mean, what is that? But man, he sure wanted us to know God's word. See, that's the administration of the church, is those that rule well. All right. Now, so these men, pastors and teachers, they're first of all to rule. Secondly, they're to rule by example. And I'm going to do this in 5 minutes and I'll be done. Not constraint. Notice what it says. Let no man despise thy youth, Paul said to Timothy, but be thou what? An example. It is right for a pastor, teacher of a church not to say, do what I say, don't do what I do. That's wrong. It's right for them to say, do what I say and watch me do it myself. And if you have any trouble understanding what the Bible says, watch me. I'll illustrate it. That's the way it's supposed to be. Okay? By example, not by constraint, all right, but by example. 1 Peter 5:3 talks about that. We'll just read it real quick. Notice there it says, the elder which among you I exhort, I'm also an elder, a witness of the sufferings of Christ, also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. Feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, notice it, not by constraint. I'm not supposed to be in your face and say, here's how you're supposed to run your life. That's not how God intended it. Not by constraint, but willingly, not for filthy lucre, not for what you get paid, but of a ready mind, neither as being lords, as there's that dictatorial thing over God's heritage, but what? By being an example. You know what I found in my life? I know some of you found the same thing. I've never had a problem following someone that was a good example. The first time I learned that was through my dad. I didn't like him, but you know, I learned it. And then the second time, that's what fit me for the Marine Corps. As my dad set a good example when I got in the Marine Corps, I found people that were leading a good example. And you know what happens? You get a bunch of folks together in the Marine Corps or any military service. You have a guy in front that says, we're going to take that hill. And they, I mean, you know it's impossible, but you know what you do? You follow them. Because they're, by example, they're in the front of the pack. They say, come on, let's go. We're going to do it. And against the odds that you know are impossible, you're willing to risk your life. That's the way God formed the church. Not by constraint, not for filthy lucre, not as being lords over God's heritage, but being an example. All right, so God wants these men to rule well. That's to take care. He wants them to rule by example. And then thirdly, that's their responsibility. This is our responsibility. They're to be received by our submission. Look what it says in Hebrews 13, 17 again. We already read it. Obey them that have the rule over you. And what? Submit. Submit yourself. All right? They care for you. Submit to it. Not to them personally, but to submit to the rule, the care that they have for you. In fact, Paul even said this in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1. He said, be ye followers of me, even as I am also of Christ Jesus. Don't just follow me. All right? But be ye followers of me, even as I am also of Christ Jesus. Follow that way. And then not only are we supposed to be submissive to them and receive them with submission, but we're supposed to receive them for honor, for their work's sake. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 12 and 13, wonderful verse. We beseech you, brethren, to know them which are labor among you and over you in the Lord's, admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. This is the way God chose to administrate a local church. They have seven people or more of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and of wisdom. They can serve the needs, the physical needs of a church, to provide for the pastors and teachers, to give themselves totally to the Word of God and to prayer, and to go forward as they care for the flock, spiritual needs, so they may grow under God. Those pastors who rule well will manage by delegation and with the body's approval. It's exampled in Acts chapter 6. We won't go there. It's pictured in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. You remember that? That's a place where Paul used the metaphor of the body, the fingers and the toes. The ear doesn't say to the eye, I have no need of you, so and forth. And it's all through delegation. And this is God's plan concerning the administration of church with regards to the who question. When God's plan is followed, the work of the church progresses well. When his plan is changed or ignored or challenged, the work of Christ and the church suffers, and eventually the church will die. I know there are many pastors who are turkeys. I guess I can say that. I've met them. I always said, you know, did God call you or did you just go? Or as the one black folk said, there's a lot of pastors today that was never called, they just went. And I think about that, and I think there's a lot of truth in that. There are some that have no business being in the ministry. But we cannot then condemn all those who are because of the few that shouldn't have been. God never called them into the ministry. They just went. But there are a great number of men in ministry who are genuine and humble and desire to be submissive to God's word. They are not opportunistic. They are not self-promoters. In fact, they're overwhelmed by the call and the responsibility placed on them. And you can tell it when you're around them. They genuinely care for people, and they seek not their own benefit, but the benefit of others. Will they make mistakes? Of course they'll make mistakes. I love this quote, Kenneth Quick. He wrote, "The only omnipotent executive chose Simon Peter." That tells us a lot. "A man of great strengths and glaring weaknesses." I mean, God used his strengths in spite of his weaknesses. Sure, they will make mistakes, but they're not intentional. Don't be critical. Don't have roast pastor for lunch, okay? Remember, the old man is still inside all of us. And he's corrupt according to the deceitful lust. Rebellion is in our bones. You don't have to try to be rebellious. You have to try not to be. The issue of authority and rebellion, it began all the way back when the morning stars sang together. The fallen one then met Eve in the Garden of Eden and deceived her. Adam fell too, but he did it willingly. Each of us has the nature of Adam. It is a nature that logically justifies doing wrong and can make every excuse in the world for doing it. But God gave to us in the church to protect against ourselves, pastors and teachers, to rule or care for us, to teach us this book so that we can be approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed. That's what God wants. That's what God did. And that is the who. Who is responsible for the management of the church? Jesus Christ, through his word, through dedication and delegation of his people. Now, next week, we're going to consider the second question. What is the main focus of the administration of the church? And I hope that you'll come back. We want to learn what we learn from God's word. We don't want to learn it from somebody's opinion. We want to know it from God's word. And I hope today you walk away and say, well, I might not have understood everything he said, but it sure is sure that he got it from the Bible and not out of the Bible, and that it'll help you. So in our relationship together, I mean, I love you guys. You're my friends, but I want what's God's best for you. And it would be a whole lot easier to stand up here today and say something wonderful is happening. And isn't it nice that we all feel warm and fuzzy, and now let's be dismissed and go home. It'd be a whole lot easier. You'd all go out, pat me on the back, well, that was a great sermon. That was wonderful. Short. I mean, I love those. And really just right, you know. And I feel so much better about myself. But that's not the way God intended it. God brought this church and the management of the church for someone just like a parent who cares for you and says, here's what God's word says. And I know you don't like it, but if you apply it, you're going to be a whole lot better off. And we walk out here. But we walk out and God did something in our life. I want to be the latter, not the first. I don't want to just walk away and feel good because someone said the right things to me. I want to know the truth. I want to know what God's. One day I'm going to stand before him, Ben. Man, there ain't anyone bad. No one next to me. And I'm going to stand and see his face. All of us will. And when that happens, I want to be able to say, I've run my race. I've finished my course. And I hope you do too. Let's bow for prayer. Father, thank you so much today for your word, our time together, a focus on your word. Thank you, Lord, for the excitement of your word. Lord, when we do it your way, it always works so much better. But there are so many churches today, they're fighting back and forth. Who sets in this pew? Who sets in that one? They didn't even shake my hand. They shook my hand too much. I wish they'd shut up. I wish they'd speak more. I wish they'd sit on this side. I wish they'd wear that tie. Do you believe she wore that dress the same, the one she wore last week? We are so filled with all those things instead of the things that we're supposed to be focusing on and doing. Lord, deliver us from that. And help us, Lord, to be managed by your word through people who care for us. and that all the people's needs are met through this delegation, this great family of people that are always going out to try to help someone else. Lord, if there's someone here this morning that knows you as their Savior, a lot of what I said, most all of what I said today is like, just, when's he going to be done? And what they really need today is not to know about the administration of the church. They need to know about Jesus and what he did for them. I pray, Lord, today that they would know that Jesus loved them more than any human being could ever love them and gave his life. He actually died on a cross, taking the penalty for their sin. And that today they'd realize that no one ever cared for them like Jesus, and that they'd give their life to you today. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that someone today would see their need and find you. For us, Lord, that are here, help us to walk the way that we should walk, to do the things that we're... And thank you, Lord, for giving us someone that will remind us your word, Christ, and your Holy Spirit through pastors and teachers. In Jesus' name. Let's stand today. We're singing a closing hymn. I love this song. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus, my Lord, will love me forever. Oh, isn't that wonderful? Can't say that about human relationships, honestly. Can't. No matter how dear they are. We're always right there at the risk of doing or saying something that someone's love will be withdrawn. But it'll never happen with Jesus. Let's sing together. Cherish that truth in your heart today. May God bless you. Have a great day. Make sure you shake hands with our visitors today. Let them know you appreciate them, or at least elbow them, one of the two. I don't know today what we do. I say hi or something, wave, or whatever we do. But make sure you let them know that you appreciate them being with us. And Sarah sat through the whole sermon, even though she knows me. Oh, man, that is a miracle right there. So have a great day and a safe week, and see you next week.